The chief of the Philippine National Police denying allegations of a cover-up in a massive drug bust last year. Our very own Rafi Santos now joins us with details. Rafi, over to you.
Yes, okay, Casey, let's get to the heart of the matter. The PNP chief has just called out DALG Secretary Benhar Abalos, saying he believes the secretary has been deliberately misinformed about what really transpired during a massive drug raid in Manila last year. PNP Chief Rodolfo Azurin Jr. also called out Abalos' accusations against some senior members of the service, as well as insinuations of a cover-up, saying these were very unfair and without basis or evidence. Citing the findings of the PNP's own special investigation task group by Major General Eliseo Cruz, Azurin argued they were on the right track and that they were on the way to identifying the people behind the pilferage of 42 kilos of shabu from a drug raid in Manila, which led to the arrest of Sergeant Rodolfo Mayo, who has since been charged and removed from the service. This has also led to the recommendation on the filing of criminal and administrative cases against 49 cops, including former Police Drug Enforcement Group Director Brigadier General Narciso Domingo, for their parts in the operation. The PNP chief also hinted at apparent moves by drug syndicates to sow discord between the DILG and the PNP, saying he believes the group has penetrated many branches of government and causing intrigue to preempt Major General Cruz's findings about the involvement of police officers in drug pilferage. Azurin also cast doubts on major drug busts such as in Pampanga, La Union, and Baguio City, saying there could have been pilferage there as well, and that he purposely turned down invitations of a photo op with the DILG secretary in these operations because he was not fully convinced about their veracity. The PNP chief, who is set to retire next week, says he has briefed President Marcos on the situation and has advised him to choose his successor carefully, saying some officers present in the above-mentioned drug busts may have been unwittingly compromised by drug syndicates bent on disrupting government. Azurin concluded by saying he and Abalos were on the same page in the war on drugs, but that he believes evidence and credible intelligence should be used to pin down suspects and due process should be accorded to all. Let's listen to some of what the PNP chief had to say.
He's too honest na kung anong nangyayari doon, yun, sinabmit lang niya. Kaya nga, sa totoo lang, masamang loob niya. Totoo naman yung sinabi niya na ako nga yung nakadiskubre ng 990, bakit ako ngayon? Definitely, we are not covering up for Mayo. Who is Mayo to me and who is Mayo na kailangan ko siyang pagtakpan? Eh siya nga yung salot, eh siya nga yung anay na isa sa mga anay na sumisira sa PNP. Di ba? Pagtatakpan ba natin yan? Di ba? No way. Focus on the real enemy. Let me call the attention also of our kind SILG, the Honorable Benjamin Benhar Abalos Jr., to take a second look on the people who may be feeding him misinformation to cast doubt on the integrity of the PNP organization, which is also under his authority. While I join the good SILG in the fight against erring personnel in the police force, let us not lose focus on the real enemy here, which is the shabu and the drug syndicates. Let's also try to respect, give them dignity, because they earned that. He just need to trust the PNP. So, yung trust the PNP leadership.
At suporta sa programa ng ating...
Back to you, Casey.
Rafi, a couple of questions for you before we let you go. You said that General Azurin said that there's no doubt about it, he and the Secretary of the Interior are on the same page. But how can he say that when he publicly calls out the Secretary Abalos there? What do you think, what do you make of the situation, Rafi? Is this shaping up to be a scenario wherein it's the DILG now versus the PNP?
Okay. General Azurin was asked during the press conference this morning about the status of his professional relationship with DILG Secretary Benhar Abalos. And he said that they remain professional and that they are one with the goals of eradicating the drug menace in the Philippines. But he says that he and Secretary Abalos have different ways of getting to that target. He likened it to a soldier being given an order to take a hill, and that he said that they have different ways on how to reach that hill. But he clarified that they are in agreement when it comes to the eradication of the problem of illegal drugs in the country, and that they remain professional. And he said that before Secretary Abalos came out with this press conference on the supposed pilferage and cover-up of the 990 kilos in Manila, that Secretary Abalos actually texted him and messaged him about the press conference. Carmina.
Rafi, why is General Azurin so sure that there was no cover-up?
Okay. General Azurin mentioned and always circled back to the fact that they formed a special investigation task group just days after that drug raid in October of last year. He says he believes that the findings of Major General Eliseo Cruz reflect that they did not have a cover-up in that particular operation, because it detailed the roles of different police officers indicated during Secretary Abalos's press conference. And he believes that these findings with evidence are enough to be able for them to file criminal and administrative charges against these people. Now, he insists that they do not have any reason to cover up the situation, because he believes that Mayo is just one of the bad rotten apples in the organization, and that they are hell-bent on discovering or finding out who is behind all these, the proliferation of drugs. And he says they are also open to expanding and even extending the special investigation task group to be able to pinpoint who these people are, Carmina.
If General Azurin stands by that investigation, why does he think that Secretary Abalos had to have his own investigation into it? The Secretary also formed his own task force to look into the matter. Go ahead, Raf.
Okay. Yes, Carmina. I remember the Secretary said that he was asking for periodic updates from the Philippine National Police, and he alleged that he was not getting it from the PNP regarding the investigation into the pilferage of the shabu confiscated in Metro in Manila last year. Azurin said that there was a very thorough investigation and very very careful in the investigation, so they had to be on a need-to-know basis, and that the different investigative bodies tasked by the PNP did not know what each other were doing until they submitted the final report. Now, Major General Cruz yesterday had a press conference, and he said that they had 21 case conferences on the subject before they came out with a recommendation, and he believes it was just bad timing that they came out with a report 1 week before Secretary Abalos came out with his press conference, Carmina.
He also said that he believes that the Secretary has been deliberately misinformed. By whom, Rafi?
Yes. General Azurin made insinuations that maybe some of the people advising telling Secretary Abalos certain things about the drug operations are deliberately misleading him. He says he believes that some members of the drug syndicates have already penetrated the higher rungs of government, and that he is now in the process of actually uncovering who these people are. And he already cautioned the president when he talked to him last week about appointing the next PNP chief, saying he needed to be careful and that to be able to know that this person was not being manipulated by these drug syndicates into what he calls being business as usual in the Philippine National Police, pertaining to the pilferage and alleged recycling of illegal drugs by some police elements during these drug raids. Carmina.
Rafi, as a final question, General Azurin also heads that five-man panel looking into or heading the internal cleansing of the National Police. If the general can make such a categorical statement, about, you know, no such cover-up happening and all that without the complete and clear picture. Does he do that as well? Is that how he is as well within that five-man panel? That if he says it, then it's the truth, Raf?
Oh, yes. That's a very interesting question, Carmina, because this whole scenario of the 990 kilos and the pilferage of 42 kilos from that drug haul actually casts some doubt on the integrity of that five-man committee. Now that we have now that the Philippine National Police Chief Azurin is also heading that as well, we do not have any information on the number of police officers or senior police officers that the list has gone down to. They said that they will finish it before his term ends. And it will be interesting to see, Carmina, how that affects, how this issue affects the results of that, five-man committee. If those results will be still be credible, and if those results will still be taken up by the NAPOLCOM and signed by the president, now that this cloud of controversy is now hovering over the PNP. For me,
and finally, you have what General Azurin is saying. You have what Secretary Abalos is saying. Between the two, you still have that case, right? The drug buy bus and the alleged cover-up. In the coming days, Rafi, what are the expected developments and where do we go from here?
Okay. One of two things, Carmina. The PNP says they are not closing their special investigation task group, and they're still continuing to probe into this 990-kilo drug raid in Manila. They say that they started with the 42 kilos because it was the pilferage that they were focusing on in the first place. They clarified that the pilferage was discovered by no less than Brigadier General Domingo, the former head of the Philippine Drug Enforcement Group of the PNP Drug Enforcement Group, and the PNP says they are now they believe that they are now on the right track into identifying these people, and they have also cast doubt on some of the drug raids that were done in the past couple of months, especially in Baguio, Poro Point, Binalon, and Pangasinan, and the one in Pampanga. And Azurin believes that some of these operations also involved pilferage by police officers, but he did not mention who these police officers are and what group they belong to. We are also now looking forward to what Secretary Abalos is going to say about this, because he held that press conference and he was adamant in the fact that he believed there was a cover-up. Mm-hmm. Interesting to see what kind of result that this will have on the relationship between the PNP and the DILG, even though they say that all things are good between the two of them.
Right. Thanks a lot. Our correspondent there, Rafi Santos, joining us this noon. Thanks, Raf. Back here in the newsroom, on to the Philippine Senate's probe into the murder of Negros Oriental Governor Roel Degamo. Suspended lawmaker Arnulfo Teves Jr., the alleged main mastermind in Degamo's killing, barred from taking part in the hearing virtually. Senate Committee on Public Order and Dangerous Drugs Chairman Senator Ronald De La Rosa cites legal concerns for the decision. According to Senate Majority Leader Joel Villanueva, Teves was reportedly seen in South Korea.
The doors are not completely shut down to Congressman Teves. If he wants to come here physically, then by all means, we will entertain. Lahat na gusto niya sasabihin, pakikinggan po natin. In the spirit of fairness, this committee would not like to be misconstrued as a one-sided committee. We want to open up all legal avenues para mapakinggan ang both sides. But physically.
Aside from Degamo's murder, the hearing aims to look into the spate of killings of other local officials. Senators maintain they will not allow the culture of impunity to prevail in the country.
The purpose of this committee hearing is to craft appropriate remedial legislation that would prevent incidents such as this in the future.
The brutality committed against Governor Degamo and the people of Negros Oriental will not be swept under the rug. Violence has no place in our society.
The Philippines Prisons Bureau Chief confident they will be able to close down the state penitentiary by 2028. The Bureau of Corrections plans to move the close to 30,000 inmates at the new Bilibid prisons in Muntinlupa to regional prisons in 5 years' time. Bilibid will then be converted into a commercial hub. BUCOR Director General Gregorio Catapang Jr. says this year they aim to transfer around 7,500 inmates from minimum and medium security compounds.
The last prison and penal farm was established in 1973. And would you imagine it was the president's father who was the last one who constructed the prison and penal farm? That was 50 years ago. That was how long the Bureau of Corrections have been forgotten, 50 years mismanagement, no infrastructure development. And I now have a very tall order to turn it around in 5 years' time. I'll do that by closing down the new Bilibid prison in Muntinlupa. And then I'll convert that into the new BUCOR Global City. I'll be leasing maybe more than 50% of the lot there, which now cost about 250 to 200,000 per square.
In other news, the Chinese embassy in Manila claims the controversial statement of its envoy and overseas Filipino workers in Taiwan was taken out of context. In a statement, the embassy said Ambassador Huang Xilian's comment was misquoted or misinterpreted. The embassy also posted a link to what it says is the original text of the envoy's speech to support their claims. Here's a portion of Wang's speech.
Some try to find excuse for the new Etka sites by citing the safety of the 150,000 Filipino overseas foreign workers in Taiwan. While China is the last country that wishes to see conflict over the strait, because people on both sides are Chinese. But we will not renounce the use of force, and we reserve the option of taking all necessary actions, necessary measures. The Philippines is suffice to unequivocally oppose Taiwan independence rather than stoking the fire by offering the US access to the military bases near the Taiwan Strait, if you care about the 150,000.
Philippine Senator Risa Ontiveros wants Chinese Ambassador to Manila Huang Xilian recalled over his anti-Taiwan advice. Ontiveros says Huang has no business being a diplomat if he cannot engage with the Philippines in a respectful manner. She adds Huang, along with China's ships in the West Philippine Sea, should pack up and leave the country. Ontiveros also says if China has issues with the U.S., it should not drag the Philippines into their fight. The Philippines preparing for any contingency to ensure the safety of Filipinos in Taiwan following that threat from China's envoy to Manila. The National Security Council also clarified the Philippines has no intention of interfering with Taiwanese affairs. Some members of the Filipino community in Taiwan called out the Chinese envoy for singling them out.
Too far from reality. You cannot single out the Filipinos because there's an EDCA agreement between the U.S. and the Philippines. If there is a problem, let's say a war or a conflict between China and Taiwan, all of us, not only the OFW, but everyone living here will be able.
China's threat against Filipinos in Taiwan over Manila's expanded Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement with Washington, not a cause for concern. That assurance coming from Manila Economic and Cultural Office Chairman Silvestre Bello III. Bello asserts the situation of Filipinos in Taiwan remains normal.
I would like to assure the relatives, the parents, the wives, or the husband of our OFWs na napakaganda ang kondisyon ng ating mga OFWs doon. Wala pong cause for alarm. I will be the first one to tell all of you kung sakaling merong emergency situation. Pero right now, wala pong ano, wala pong tension, normal lang Taiwan. I don't see the relation of the welfare and the protection of our overseas Filipino workers in Taiwan and the additional presence of EDCA sites in the Philippines.
Former National Security Advisor Clarita Carlos weighs in on the expanded defense deal between Manila and Washington. She says China practically pushed the Philippines to the arms of the U.S. due to its continuing aggression in the West Philippine Sea.
We really have to walk that fine line between leaning for our military and defense towards the United States of America and leaning on commerce and trade and other relationship, social and culture, with China. Please, you know, from your end, you only need to change your behavior in the South China Sea. And believe me, there will be a sea change in our relationship with your country.
For retired General Adalberto Adan, while government can still pursue ties with China, it must firmly stand up to Beijing when needed.
China doesn't respect weakness. No? Kailangan magpakita ka ng paninindigan gaya ng ibang bansa like Vietnam, like Indonesia. Their armed forces are less capable than China. However, pinapakita nila, we will resist. We will give you a bloody nose. Even if we know that you are so far more powerful, pero hindi kami, it will not be a walk in the park. So yun ang dinedevelop natin, yung credible defense capability, no? Na we show them that we are resolute, no? Kaya nga ang aking panawagan is ang ating dapat stance diyan, yung cooperate where we could, but we should resist where we should. Resolutely.